Let's learn how nodes work in DaVinci Resolve and in what order you should apply your modifications and effects. If you already know DaVinci, you can jump to the nodes order chapter to watch only the part where I show the order in which I apply modifications and effects. If instead you're new to the subject, I suggest watching my tutorial on video scopes, which you can find here, before jumping into this one. You can also download the clips I'm using in this tutorial from the link in the description. Nodes are displayed in this window here in the color tab. There are two dots on the side of the window. The left one is the clip input and the right one is the clip output. The signal travels through the line from left to right, getting corrected by any node it finds along the way. Each node has two inputs and two outputs. The green inputs and outputs are for transferring the RGB channels, while the blue ones are for transferring the alpha channel, which is the transparency mask. There are two types of nodes. A serial node is a node that follows another node. To create one, press Alt S or Option S on a Mac, and you'll create a node after the one you have selected. Press Shift S to create one before the one you've selected. The second type of node is a parallel node. You can create one by pressing Alt plus P or Option plus P. The node is then created in parallel to the one you have selected, meaning that they get the source from the same origin and their effects are mixed together. The main difference here is that a serial node gets its image from the node before, so it is affected by its changes. A parallel node instead is not affected by the other parallel nodes. Then there are three types of mixers. The parallel mixer, which is created automatically with parallel nodes. The layer mixer, which allows you to use composite modes inside your node tree, for example screen or multiply. If you don't know what I'm talking about, please watch my video on the secrets of the inspector tab. Lastly, the key mixer, which can mix together keys from different nodes, getting them from the blue output of the node. Keys are indicated by a dotted line. A couple more shortcuts that help browsing. You can disable a node by pressing Ctrl plus D or Command plus D on a Mac. And you can bypass all color grading by pressing Shift plus D. You can also shift node positions by pressing Ctrl and dragging one node on top of another. So, what is the logic for using nodes? The idea is that you do one thing and one thing only for each node. There are a myriad of possible modifications you can apply in DaVinci, and they can be mixed in the same node. But if you do too many things in the same node, you risk losing control of your grade and having a hard time walking back if you need to. For example, in your first node you can change the exposure of the clip, then in your second node you can change the tint. You can then toggle them on and off separately. A good rule of thumb is to give meaningful names to each node. If you can give your node a name that clearly explains what it does, then you're using them correctly. If you can't, then you're probably doing too many things inside a single node. You can rename your nodes by right-clicking and selecting Node Label. I recommend renaming all your nodes, otherwise you'll quickly forget what they are doing. You can rearrange your nodes in a tidier way by right-clicking and selecting Cleanup Node Graph. You can also duplicate your node tree by pressing Ctrl plus Y, then move from one grade version to the next by clicking Ctrl plus N for next and Ctrl plus B for before. It's time to start building our node tree. There are two types of corrections you can apply. A primary correction is a correction that applies to the whole image. The usual primaries are exposure, color balance, saturation, contrast, tint, etc. The advantage of primary corrections is that they make it easier to copy and paste a grade between clips. Hence, the more primary correction you use, the easier it will be to go through your grade. In fact, most films are graded with just primary corrections. As a rule of thumb, primaries are made in serial nodes, but that might not always be the case. The second type is a secondary correction. A secondary is a modification that applies only to a portion of the image. The portion can be selected by an HSL mask, which is a key of a color frequency, a power mask drawn in the image, or a combination of the two. I'll make a separate tutorial in the future about secondaries. The advantage of secondary corrections is that they make it possible to touch only a part of the image, hence allowing for precise corrections. The disadvantage is that secondaries make copying and pasting grades much harder, because we'll have to adjust the keys and power windows in each separate clip. It's also very easy to forget about a secondary and leave it where it's not needed. Secondaries are usually done in parallel nodes, although this is not always the case. Let's now get into the order of how corrections are applied. Let's start with the LUT. The LUT, or lookup table, is a preset that your camera manufacturer provides to allow you to go from the ungraded log footage, which looks kinda grey, to the Rec. 709 standard, which is the reproduction standard for HD TVs and screens. LUTs are a standard in any editing and post-production software, so what I'll say here applies to any such program. In DaVinci, LUTs are accessible by right-clicking on the node, selecting LUT, then pressing to the correct one for your shot. The example clip is shot in Sony S-Log3 S-Gamut 3, so I'll choose that one. Now your clip should be converted to Rec. 709. So the question is, should you start grading after your LUT or before your LUT? Common sense suggests you should do it after and use your LUT as a starting point, but I argue you should do it before the LUT. You see, LUTs apply curves to the image to make it display properly, but at the same time, they are cutting out much of the information the clip had in the log file, which is why we shoot in log, the saturated and the compressed footage. It is to keep details that otherwise would get lost with compression. So if you color grade after the LUT, you have basically deleted all the power of the log file. Let's look at an example. Here is a clip that, for the purpose of this exercise, looks like it was shot overexposed. If you look at the waveform though, we see that there is no loss of information in the highlights, as no part of the image is clipping. When we apply the LUT, the sky gets completely blown out by the curves. If we try to correct the sky after the LUT, we won't get a good result because the information has already been lost, making it much harder to recover detail. But this is no problem if we do it before the LUT, as we have access to all the information in the log file. There is a second reason why you want your LUT after your primaries and secondaries in the node graph, and that is because you can use the LUT, and in general, your overall look, as a way to keep your grade consistent throughout the edit. LUTs reinterpret your footage with a contrast curve, a color palette, and a specific saturation. If you place it near the end of your edit, you can use those settings to funnel all your previous modifications in the same direction. If you do it the other way around, you're spreading out your modifications in different directions, making it much harder to be consistent. Let's look at an example. Here I'm using a custom LUT that applies a particular film stock color to the S-Log S-Gamut 3 of my clip. The colors are very different from the original Rec. 709 conversion, and it looks like some colors are completely missing. For example, green is not very present and is instead tilted towards yellow. Now I'll try to put green back into the clip before the LUT conversion. If I play with the hue, you can see that the LUT has a very specific way in which the green color bends around the vector scope, meaning that just certain frequencies of green are allowed to pass through. If I do it after the LUT, the green simply rotates in any direction. It is a subtle difference, but it can compile over time if you add more and more layers of grading. The same applies to black levels. The LUT places a limit to the black level, and no matter how much I push it down, I cannot reach total black. After the LUT instead, you can have any black level you want. Again, the risk here is to having consistent black levels through your grade. Here's a simple rule to create consistency in your grades. Place any node that creates a look near the end of the tree. The look creates a funnel through which any image passes, getting conformed, while keeping each node that creates custom modifications near the start of the tree, where you're free to move things around with the full information at your disposal. A more modern alternative for LUTs are CSTs. CST stands for Color Space Transform, and it is a somewhat new way to convert footage to Rec. 709 without using LUTs. It follows a logic that was developed for movies with the ACES framework, which is meant to be device independent, meaning that your look is not connected to the device you're using to film or the device you used to watch. DaVinci developed its own workflow that is great for grading, especially if you're using more than one camera source for a project, for example, a mirrorless and a drone. The first step is to go to File, Project Settings, Color Management, and make sure your timeline is set to DaVinci Wide Gamut Intermediate as the timeline color space and Rec 709 Gamma 2.4 as the output color space. Then delete the LUT and create two nodes. Go to Effects and look for Color Space Transform, then drag the effect in both nodes. Now, in the first node, you're going to convert the camera color space, in this case Sony Slog 3 SGAM 3, to DaVinci Wide Gamut Intermediate, which is a very large color space, making the grid device independent from the Sony camera. In the second node, instead, we are going to convert the color space from Wide Gamut Intermediate to Rec 709 Gamma 2.4. Let's rename the two CSTs. The first one will be Slog DVG, the second DVG Rec. Your grid is now going to be divided in two areas. Between the two CSTs, the color space is much larger than the normal log space of your camera. This is the perfect place to do your primaries and secondaries. After a second CST, instead, it's a great place to create your funnel, which is your look, starting with your Rec 709 conversion. Let's start adding primaries. The common node tree you will find in other tutorials has two or more serial nodes at the start between the two CSTs, which are for exposure and white balance, and maybe others. Then a series of parallel nodes. This is the official correct ways to use nodes, so I suggest you to stick to it when starting out. My usual node tree is a bit different and follows the funnel idea. I start with a series of parallel nodes for my secondaries, I usually place 5, then I place exposure, white balance, and so on. This is because I like to go in and tweak exposure and white balance multiple times, and I don't want to lose my keys in the secondaries, which I would if they are placed after the primaries. If they always get their image from the source input, there is no risk of losing the mask. The rest of the nodes are the same in both versions of the node tree. I create a node for contrast and saturation. By contrast, I don't just mean the contrast slider, but any effect that changes the small, medium, or large contrast of an image. For example, the texture pop or contrast pop effects, or the custom mask I created, which you can download from the link in the description. Lastly, I start modifying my color scheme, adding hues, tints, and any other slight modification in how color is represented. For these, I really like Mononode's DCTLs. Check their videos if you want to know more. There are a few effects that work better after the Rec 709 conversion. The first might be another LUT. There are a few already installed in DaVinci, for example the famous Kodak film look. There are others you can download. Before using them, check the color space they need to work, as it might not be Rec 709 Gamma 2.4. The Kodak look, for example, wants a Rec 709 Cineon film log. Let's look at other effects. If I want to add film grain, I'll do that at the very end of the tree. This is because grain is affected by the luminosity of the footage. If the luminosity changes, so should the grain, hence last place in a serial node. Glows and halations go before the film grain, as they affect luminosity. Same goes for ray lights, aperture diffraction, and reflections. I usually place these in parallel nodes, as it is much easier to control them without them interacting with each other. Now it looks like a mess, so give me a couple of minutes to fix the effect. Okay, much better. Vignettes go after the look and before the glows, as a bright object that is close to a vignette might glow over the vignette, which makes it look more realistic. I usually place blurs after the vignette, but before the glows, and above all, the film grain. If you place blur after the grain, you'll simply delete it. Blurs should always be placed in a serial node, as they create weird artifacts if placed in a parallel node. Then comes noise reduction, or other denoise plugins, such as Reduce Noise by Neat Video. I usually place this either as a first node before the CST, or as a second node, depending on how strong is the noise that I need to take out. If the noise only affects one part of the image, for example, a color pushed out from the blacks, I might add denoise as a secondary only in parts of the image. In this case, I place it after the secondaries in a serial node, not in a parallel one. Otherwise, the noise might spill out from the other nodes. Finally, my last node is named Out, and it's a simple control node. Here, I dial in my final black level, white level, and minor fixes, such as a cap on saturation. This is the tiny tip of the funnel. I'll now apply the same trick to another clip. First, I delete all modifications and disable all effects, in a way that does not affect the clip, if not for the log Rec 709 conversion. But I make sure that I keep the names of each node. Names are a good reminder of what types of changes I can do and in what order. In the case of this clip, it too is a Sonys Log 3 as Gamma 3, so I don't need to change the source color space. What I want to do in this clip is find a deeper and warmer color palette that is analog and natural, and complements the man's face. As I have all the notes ready, I can just follow the notes from left to right and evaluate each passage. Of course, there's no need to use everything in your grade. You can use just part of it. In fact, most of the times, the least you do in your grade, the better the result. In this next clip, the shot was very overexposed, but information was still all there. So I felt it was only necessary to bring it back to a more visible area and give its colors more division. It is fairly easy to then copy and paste the same color grade to another clip of the same scene. Just beware of the secondary masks. Here I used 4 parallel nodes and keys, so you have to go back and check what each of them does and fix it to make it work on the new clip. Or I can just disable a parallel if I don't need it. If you're interested in how I made the custom contrast mask, go ahead and watch this video where I explain how it works.